Okay, how did we get here?
Therapy.
Let's start with First Person Shooter, a song by Drake on his newest album, For All the Dogs, featuring J. Cole. That's where we're going to start today.
First person shooter mode, we turning your song to a funeral. To them niggas that say they want office, you better be talking about working in cubicles. Yeah, them boys had a lot, but I knew the code. A lot of niggas debating my numero. Not the three, not the two, I'm the UNO.
So J. Cole comes into this song with a lot of energy, talking about how he's not the three, he's not the two, he's actually the one. I want you to keep that in mind moving forward. Just write that down, make a note of it, just lock it away. Just think about that. He's not three, he's not two, he's number one, okay?
Yeah. Numero UNO. Me and Drizzy, this shit like the Super Bowl. Man, this shit done it big as the... Big as the what? Big as the what? Big as the what? Big as the Super Bowl. But the difference is, it's just two guys playing shit that they did in the studio. Niggas usually send they verses back to me and they be terrible just like a two-year-old. A
lot of dad bars from Drake ever since he was kind of forced to embrace the fact that he had a child. The verses be terrible like a two-year-old, you know, terrible twos. You get it. I just want to make sure that I'm giving enough like context and feedback on this song, so it's not like you're just tuning into a podcast to listen to somebody else's song. First Person Shooter, by the way, is one of my favorite songs that I've heard this year. I don't want what happens after this song to affect the fact that I do enjoy the song, okay? Let's keep listening, because there's a lot of important stuff here that's going to be very important later.
I love a dinner with some fine women. When they start debating about who the GOAT, I'm like, go ahead, say it then. Who the GOAT? Who the GOAT? Who the GOAT? Who the GOAT? Who you bitches really rooting for? Like a kid that had bad from January to November, nigga, it's just you and Cole.
So now Drake is making it known that when people were debating who the GOAT is, the greatest of all time when it comes to rappers, hip-hop, etc., it's really just between him and J. Cole. Interesting.
It ain't no follow for me. Still in this bitch getting bigger. They waiting on the kid to come drop like a father to be. Love when they argue the hardest MC. Is it K-Dot? Is it Aubrey or me? We the big three like we started a league. But right,
I just wanted to highlight that moment. Because that moment.
Is it K-Dot? Is it Aubrey or me? We the big three like we started a league.
Did not sit well with one Kendrick Lamar Duckworth. So it goes without saying that the biggest three names in rap or hip-hop in the past decade has been Kendrick Lamar, J. Cole, and Drake. Drake clearly has the most commercial success. Kendrick Lamar clearly has the most critical acclaim. J. Cole seems to have a great deal of respect as far as a rapper that has displayed a good amount of longevity, technical skill, and success when it comes to rap albums that have minimal, oftentimes, no features. J. Cole has shown a great deal of talent and success since his breakout album 2014 Forest Hill Drives, which of course came out in 2014, all the way through present day. So for the past decade, J. Cole has been one of the top artists in the game. It goes without saying that Drake has been a big deal ever since Take Care, one of my favorite rap albums ever, dropped in 2011. That was 13 years ago. We're talking Obama's first term. Drake was a very big deal with songs like Headlines and Take Care with Rihanna and Marvin's Room, just to name a few. All the way up until Nothing Was the Same with songs like Started from the Bottom. And then, if you're reading this, it's too late. Songs like Energy and 10 Bands, that tape with Future, who, well, we'll talk about later. 2016 with Views had One Dance on it, which isn't a rap song, but was listened to, I don't know, maybe a billion times or so. So we're talking 2011 to 2016. That's 5 years right there. 2018, Scorpion comes out. Nice for what? God's Plan. Another couple billion listens. So Drake, it goes without saying, really big deal. Kendrick Lamar, I mean, to drop back-to-back classic albums, I don't know if there have ever been two albums back-to-back as awesome and as successful as Good Kid, Mad City and then To Pimp a Butterfly. To Pimp a Butterfly is, in fact, my favorite rap album ever. So for J. Cole to come out and say, hey, I'm the best among us, is quite a bold claim. So we're going to go ahead and skip the rest of this song. If you want to listen to the rest of First Person Shooter, if you haven't already heard it, go ahead and do that. I'm not going to play the rest of it. The point is, J. Cole came out on this song and said, it's really just the three of us, but I feel like I'm kind of at the top here. So let's hear what Kendrick has to say about that in a feature that he did on
Metro Boomin' and Future's album, We Don't Trust You. This came out of nowhere. It was a very big deal. Let's hear what Kendrick Lamar's response is to being in the big three and not number one.
These niggas talking out of their neck. Don't put no coughing out of your mouth. I'm way too paranoid for a threat. Hey, let's get it, bro. D.O.T., the money, power, respect.
The last one is better.
Say yes, a lot of goofies with a check. I mean,
Shout out Dissect Podcast for making this point. But I really do believe when Kendrick Lamar says there's a lot of goofies with a check, I really do think he's directly referring to Drake. Because Goofy is like a silly dog from Disney. And check refers to... It could mean a verified check mark on Instagram or Twitter. It could mean check as in goofy, silly people with a lot of money. And it could also mean check like Nike, who Drake has a deal with. And I know what you're thinking. That sounds like a reach. It is absolutely not. Kendrick Lamar received a Pulitzer Prize for his lyricism, wordplay, and narrative storytelling for the album Damn. So I don't think it's that much of a stretch. Just to be clear, the reason why we're listening to this specific verse is because this is a response to J. Cole and Drake directly. So this is the start of the actual beef. Let's continue.
I hope them sentiments symbolic. Oh, my temperament bipolar, I choose violence. Okay, let's get it up. It's time for him to prove that he's a problem. Niggas clicking up, but pay not be legit. No 40 water, tell him. Aw. Yeah, get up with me, fuck sneak this and first person shooter, I hope they came with three switches. I crash out like fuck rap, this Melly Mel if I had to, got two T's with me, I'm snatching chains and burning tattoos, it's up.
So it's very clear that Kendrick Lamar is referring directly to Drake and J. Cole by mentioning the first person shooter song by name. He also talks about people clicking up, the two of them coming together and saying that they are the two best in the game. He also says he's a... snatching chains and burning tattoos. I do not know what that is referring to. I don't think that's a literal thing, which is ironic because he just says, I hope your sentiments are symbolic, which is basically his way of saying, I hope you guys are joking. I hope that when you guys are talking about being the two biggest rappers and it really just being the three of us, but I'm not number one. I hope you guys are just like, I hope this is all like symbolic of something else because you can't be for real. But he is being very clear about who he's talking to, what he's talking about. And I love it. Like this is something that's been missing from rap in a long time. Not diss tracks in general, but diss tracks between rappers that are this big, like the biggest. It's really awesome. And hearing this was so jarring for me as somebody that's a fan of all three of them.
Lost too many soldiers not to play it safe. If he walk around with that stick, it ain't Andre 3K. Think I won't drop the location. I still got PTSD. Motherfuck the big three. Nigga, it's just big me. Nigga, boom! I'm really like that. And your best work is a light pack. Nigga, Prince outlived Mike Jack. Nigga, boom!
Unless it wasn't super clear that Kendrick Lamar is talking about these two individuals. I mean, he literally... him saying, fuck the big three, it's just big me, is a direct response to J. Cole saying that the three of them are basically the big three. And he emphasizes this by screaming bum multiple times, which I think is the most underrated and funny part of this entire diss. Just yelling the word bum, like Kendrick Lamar yelling bum has been stuck in my head for weeks now. Every time somebody does something that is unsatisfactory, I just hear that sound, just him yelling bum in my head. So thank you, Kendrick, for that. But he wants to make it clear that we are not the same. We are on different levels. I have accomplished more, or people like me more, or my work speaks for itself in a way that is completely different than the both of you. So yeah, let's go ahead and finish the track and then we'll talk more about what's to come.
For all your dogs getting buried, that's a K with all these nines. He gon' see Pet Cemetery, nigga.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. For all your dogs getting buried, For All the Dogs is the name of Drake's album. So he's like, your album is getting buried.
Boom!
That's a K with all them nines. He gon' see Pet Cemetery?
Oh my God!
I mean, what a beautiful way to end a diss verse. I mean... a lot of times, many great movies are ruined by the third act, by the ending. But what a beautiful and succinct way to end a diss. For all your dogs getting buried, that's a K with all the nines. K for Kendrick, nine with the guns. He gonna see Pet Cemetery where dogs go to die. I mean, chef's kiss. Beautiful. I love it. So J. Cole comes out, says, we're the best. I'm the best. We're the big three, but I'm the UNO.
Uno?
Drake says, it's really just, it's J. Cole and I. We're looking at each other like the Spider-Man meme. It's really just the two of us at the top. We're big as the Super Bowl. Kendrick comes in and says, your best work is a light pack, which is really, really tough. That's a really tough thing to say. To say the best thing you've ever accomplished is pretty mid. It's kind of light. It's kind of light work. But Kendrick has a point. Not that their best work is trash, because I think some of Drake's best work is really, really, really impressive. J. Cole, also. I'm not as big of a fan as J. Cole albums as the average J. Cole fan. But there are some verses, there is some wordplay, there is some lyricism. When J. Cole is at his best, I believe he's one of the best. So for Kendrick to call that a light pack, very, very, very rude. Very, very disrespectful. Now, I love the fact that we aren't too far into this podcast, and I feel comfortable going ahead and getting into J. Cole's response to Kendrick Lamar, which it turns out has kind of a sad ending. So we're going to go through J. Cole's response to Kendrick Lamar saying that he's a bum, his best work's a light pack, F the big three, it's just big me. Let's hear what J. Cole has to say in response at the end of a tape, a collection of songs that J. Cole released titled Might Delete Later. There's a song called 7-Minute Drill that has now been deleted, but that doesn't really mean anything because when it comes to the internet, mistakes are forever, as Childish Gambino once said. And even though J. Cole would decide to delete this diss track, I think it's important to highlight some of the moments from that diss track before we, you know, completely release J. Cole from this beef. Spoiler alert, J. Cole lost. If there was a fight that Kendrick started with like that, saying that his best work was a light pack and he's a bum, unfortunately, J. Cole decided to gracefully bow out after releasing his diss track. We'll get into that. First, let's listen to J. Cole's response.
Yeah. Turn it up.
First of all, I hate this beat.
Yeah, turn the vocal up. Light work, like it's PWC. It's a cold world, keep the heat under your seat. I got a phone call, they say that somebody dissing. You want some attention, it come with extensions. My dog like say the word, he on bullshit, he itching. I'm putting so much work in these streets, he got pinching. I told him chill out, how I look having henchmen. If shots get to popping, I'm the one doing the clinching.
Nothing has happened yet.
And I came up in a veil, so I'm good when it's tension. He's still doing shows, but fell off like the Simpsons. Your first shit was classic, your last shit was tragic. Your second shit put niggas to sleep, but they gassed it. Your third shit was massive, and that was your prime. I was trailing right behind, and I just now hit mine.
Look, I'm going to stop this right there. And if you want to listen to the rest of this diss track, you can either find it online or I'll leave a link in the description. This is where the diss track already lost me. Because him trying to, before anything else, discredit Kendrick Lamar's albums. Kendrick Lamar's albums are so undeniably good that this is such, it's probably the worst thing that J. Cole could have tried to diss Kendrick Lamar on. Let's just go through what he says about these albums. Your first shit was classic, your last shit was tragic. Now, here's the thing. Of course, the first one is classic. First of all, we're on a diss track, and you're talking about how somebody's album is a classic. I feel like you're already kind of being a little bit too nice. The guy just screamed that you're a bum like four times, said your best work is a light pack. You come in, and one of the first things you say is, your first album, dude, it was a classic. I liked it. You're already losing me. Your last... He says, your last shit was tragic. Now, Mr. Morale, the Big Steppers, I'm not going to hold you. J. Cole has a point here. There's a lot of sad stuff on that album. So maybe, yeah. I mean, you could call it tragic. But to say it was a bad album, I wouldn't go that far. Just because something is the least hype of a bunch doesn't mean that it's not good at all. I like N95. I mean, even some of the sadder songs on there, one of the more introspective songs like Auntie Diaries and Mother I Sober, I believe is the name of the song. There are a couple of low points on there, but songs like Savior and Mirror, and I mean, it's just a pretty good album. I mean, saying that he's still doing shows but fell off like The Simpsons, first of all, just kind of corny. You're trying to make a diss and you're saying that somebody fell off like The Simpsons. First of all, The Simpsons has been going on forever. Bad example. If Kendrick Lamar is like The Simpsons, what an unbelievable run. And Kendrick Lamar is still pretty popular. so yeah. But this is the part that truly I find unforgivable. Your second shit put people to sleep, but they gassed it.
So that was a fucking lie.
To Pimp a Butterfly. The best and my favorite rap album I have ever heard. What part of this is boring exactly?
We gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright. Nigga, we gon' be alright.
So J. Cole's diss track was not that great, okay? And everybody that was not a J. Cole fan, like a hardcore J. Cole fan, because, again, I like J. Cole. But I heard the diss track and I was like, first of all, you're lying. Secondly, the beat's not great. It has not even in the same universe as the Like That beat. I mean, the Like That beat is one of the better beats I've ever heard. That goes crazy, okay? So to come in on a trash beat, the lyrics have to be spectacular. But one of the first things you say is that To Pimp a Butterfly was boring. Shut up, J. Cole. You don't even mean it. And I'm not going to go through J. Cole's whole apology. J. Cole's whole thing is, hey, man, I was out here trying to discredit this dude's discography. He's at a festival live show, and he's basically saying, hey, guys, I just want to squash the beef, dude. I don't even really mean the diss track. I'm actually going to delete it, which is hilarious because the song is on a tape that's called Might Delete Later, and he literally deleted it later. But that's besides the point. J. Cole doesn't really want problems. He says that he's just a man of peace. He likes Kendrick Lamar, and he's, like, apologizing. It's very awkward. I really hate it. I'm not upset that J. Cole doesn't want beef with Kendrick. I'm not upset that he doesn't want a diss track out where he's talking about how To Pimp a Butterfly isn't that good of an album. I'm upset that he created it because of pressure and then put it out and then deleted it. I just think it's lame. I'm sorry. Like, he apologized. I guess I accept the apology. I don't really care. Kendrick's got to feel great, by the way. He's like, I didn't even get a chance to come back and, you know, make another verse or another song to go at J. Cole. J. Cole gave up. I didn't even have to do anything. He just felt so much shame. So, you know what? I feel like we're doing pretty good on time. Let's go ahead and get into Drake's response, because Drake's response is real and it goes hard. And it's not nice, and I like that. So let's listen to Push-Ups by Drake.
Hey, I could never be nobody number one fan. Your first number one, I had to put it in your hand. You pussies can't get booked outside America for Nan. I'm out in Tokyo because I'm big in Japan. I'm the hit maker y'all depend on. Backstage in my city, it was friend zone. You won't never take no chain off of us. How the fuck you bitch stepping with a size 7 man's on?
First of all, it goes without saying that this is a lot meaner than the J. Cole attempt. First things first, he says, I can never be nobody's number one fan. Future, on his track, said that Drake was his number one fan. So he's directly addressing him. He says, your first number one, I had to put it in your hand. Basically, Future's only good songs. A lot of his best songs are with Drake as a feature. He talks about being big in Japan. Somebody check the numbers on that, but I'm sure it's not crazy. Drake says he's the hit maker that y'all depend on. The reason why this is relevant is because by the time Drake was able to get this diss track out, so many people had dissed him. The Weeknd had dissed him. Kendrick, of course, dissed him. He's on a Future song. And Future and Drake used to be boys. They made an entire album together. They've made many, many, many a track together. And a lot of Future's biggest songs had Drake on them. So it's very, very bold of him to make that diss towards Drake, to allow that energy towards Drake. So and how you big stepping with a size 7 men's on, that is very clearly a shot at Kendrick. And also the cover art for this the cover art for this song is basically what it looks like if you look inside a shoe that has size 7 men's. You would see that this code on it. So, and the big stepper
The Big Steppin' is obviously a reference to Kendrick Lamar's newest album, Mr. Morale and the Big Stepper. So he's calling him a small person. He says no one's going to take a chain off of him because Kendrick Lamar said that he's snatching chains. So Drake is like, I'd love to see you try, you small fry. Ooh, ho, ho, bars. Maybe we should have put that one in there. Also, yeah, right after he says, this is the bark with the bite, what's up? Reference to For All the Dogs. So yeah, this is starting out very good. Let's listen to some more because there are no wasted bars here, it feels like.
This the part with the bite, nigga, what's up? I know my picture on the wall when y'all cook up. Extortion, baby, whole career, you been shook up. Cause top told you drop it, give me 50 likes of push-ups. Cool, your last one brick, you really not on shit. They make excuses for you cause they hate to see me lit. Pull your contract cause we gotta see the split. The way you doing splits, bitch, your pants might rip.
A lot of funny bars here. That's such a Drake line. To be like, the way your contract is split, the splits are so crazy, your pants might rip. Every time I hear that, I think, because I've listened to this song a bunch of times. Every time I hear that, I think of that episode of SpongeBob where he ripped his pants. He's like, I ripped my pants. That song goes hard. I might use that as the outro for this.
We are using it as the outro.
But yeah, he starts talking about the splits because apparently, allegedly, reportedly, Kendrick Lamar has a deal where 50% of what he makes goes to his label, which is such a terrible deal. Imagine every single time, let's say you have a paycheck that pays you $2,000. Imagine giving up half of that. $1,000 of every $2,000 you make is going to whoever signed you. What an awful deal. And for somebody that claims to be on top, who's saying, forget a big three, it's big me. Yeah, so the biggest is giving half of their money to their label. Not a great look at all. So yeah, Drake's cooking.
You better do that motherfucking show inside the bitty. Maroon 5 need a verse, you better make it witty. Then we need a verse for the Swifties. Top say drop, you better drop and give them 50.
This is not the first time that Drake, this is not the last time that Drake will mention Taylor Swift. So he's basically saying Maroon 5 need a verse, you better make it witty. So Kendrick, although he's somebody that comes off as this very tough guy talking about snatching chains and burning tattoos, he talks about kind of being straight out the hood from Compton, you know, like a real tough guy. But he'll hop on a track with Taylor Swift. And look, there's nothing wrong with hopping on a track with Taylor Swift, but it's hard to come out and say that you're this big tough guy and then hop on the Bad Blood remix at least twice because she had to do Taylor's version. He had to go and re-record his verse again. So, you know, interesting. Oh, and then Drake proceeds to call him a pipsqueak, which is just funny, man.
Pipsqueak, pipe down. You ain't in no big three. SZA got you wiped down. Travis got you wiped down. Savage got you wiped down. Like your label, boy, you in a scope right now. And you gon' feel the aftermath of what I write down. I'm at the top of the mountain, so you tight now. Just to add his talk with your ass, I had to hike down. Big difference between Mike then and Mike now.
I feel like the sequence of bars is the most slept on in this entire song because Drake says a lot of cutting stuff to a lot of people, mainly Kendrick Lamar. But these bars right here are special. They deserve recognition. I know I sound like I am just riding Drake so hard right now. I don't care, man. I just appreciate good art. I just want to go over this really quickly. Obviously, there's the, you know, like your label, you in a scope right now. So Drake, you know, I have you in your sights. You're also Interscope. You know, it's whatever. It's a nice little wordplay. This part right here, though, I'm at the top of the mountain. So you tight now, just to have this talk with yo ass, I had to hike down. That's, come on, man. These are bars. Big difference between Mike then and Mike now goes so hard. People don't even realize. So Drake and Kanye West, who we might talk about later, and Kendrick Lamar. Everybody's claiming to be the next Michael Jackson. Kendrick Lamar is wearing the glove at his concerts occasionally. Drake, at the end of First Person Shooter, was talking about how he's one away from Michael, you know, as far as number ones, as far as Billboard success. Everybody wants to be Michael Jackson. Everybody's claiming that they're Michael Jackson. And Drake is saying there's a big difference between Mike then and Mike now. Everybody knows Michael Jackson was a very soft-spoken, non-confrontational human being. And Drake is saying the new Michael Jackson, which is him, is mean. He's outspoken. He's loud. And it's tough. Now, this next part kind of ties back into the very beginning of this episode.
Metro!
And it's turned into one of the funniest memes, just one of the funniest ongoing bits that has ever happened in hip-hop.
since I've been alive. Just listen. There's a point where the music cuts out entirely just to make sure that you hear what you're about to hear.
What the fuck is this, a 20v1, nigga? What's a prince to a king? He a son, nigga. Get more love in a city that you from, nigga. Metro, shut your whole ass up and make some drums, nigga.
I have never in my entire life, in the history of listening to rap music, heard a rapper target a producer, someone that doesn't even rap. Just the guy that made the beat for the person that dissed you. To tell them to just shut up and make drums is so rude. It's so dismissive. The man gets one bar. He gets one line. Not even a full, like, rhyme scheme. Not even, like, a A-B-B-A. Like, not even... No punchline. No entendre. No simile. It's just shut up. Shut up. Go make some beats. Stop. So that's pretty great. I appreciate that. Like, don't even be in the studio with the person that is dissing me. Shut up. I just really wanted to highlight that. That is so good.
Hey, I be with some bodyguards like Whitney. Top say, drop your little midget ass. Better fucking, hey, better drop and give me 50. Hey, drop and give me 50. Drop and give me 50. Hey, niggas really got me out here talking like I'm 50. Niggas really got me out here rapping what I'm living. I might take your latest girl and cuff her like I'm Ricky. Can't believe he jumping in, this nigga turning 50. Every song that made it on a chart he got from Drizzy. Spend that little check, you gotta stay about my business.
By the way, Rick Ross also dissed Drake, which is, what a compliment. To have this many people dissing you at the same time. Future is dissing you. The Weeknd is dissing you. Rick Ross is dissing you. Kendrick Lamar is dissing you. ASAP Rocky is also dissing Drake. And it's just fascinating. All of these people have made songs with Drake. And to all attack him at the same time, it's almost like, do you even really? Drake could have actually been fine by not replying at all. He didn't even have to do anything. Just the fact that like 8 people are trying to insult him simultaneously is kind of a win in itself. He could have just come out and tweeted like, how many people are going to diss me at the same time? Like, you guys are the ones that are clicking up. I actually don't know if Kendrick Lamar wanted this level of like Avengers team up to go against Drake. I think Kendrick Lamar would have been fine going at it on his own. If anything, I think it's complicated things for Kendrick. Somebody that sees themselves at the top of the hip hop game. Now, Drake can't even diss him back. He has to diss like 9 other people at the same time. It's tough. It's getting tough out here. I also don't want to not mention this. Drake mentioning Whitney by name. Whitney is the name of Kendrick Lamar's partner, the mother of his child, I'm pretty sure. And apparently he's been having some issues with his relationship, and Drake is highlighting that here, which is, again, you know, just objectively not kind, but, you know, that's what happens. This is rap beef. I don't think there are really any lines that need to be drawn. Drake took a pretty public L when it came to his rap beef with Pusha T. It got to the point where Drake didn't even want to say the guy's name out loud. He got into a beef with Pusha T, and Pusha T decided to tell everybody, hey guys, by the way, Drake has a son. I don't know if any of you guys have heard of it, and nobody had. No one even knew. But Pusha T came out and was like, you're hiding a child. And Drake then had to be like, hey guys, I guess, you know, I do have a child. Didn't really want to share that with everybody because, you know, the internet, people are mean and I don't want my child being bullied or anything like that. But Pusha T was like, there are no rules in this rap beef. And now Drake is coming back like, Rick Ross, you're a chubby dude. You're like 50 years old and your career is literally nothing without me. Kendrick Lamar, heard you had some problems with your relationship. Got to be tough. Oh, by the way, you're a pipsqueak. You're a midget. I didn't even know you could say that. I'm pretty sure you can't. Editor Derek, you might have to cut that out.
You'll be all right.
Sorry to little people if you're listening to my show. And he's going all out. He has even more. I don't think we're going to get into it today. I might have to do a follow-up because Drake dropped another diss before Kendrick even had a chance to respond, which is... A real chess move. We'll get into the details of that. But first, let's just finish this song. My goodness.
In that fucking song, y'all got to not start to beef with us. This shit been brewing in a pot, now I'm heating up. I don't care what Cole think, that dot shit was weak as fuck. Champagne tripping, he is not fucking easing up.
Also underrated, one of the funniest lines in the song. I don't care what J. Cole is talking about. Like, I know J. Cole dropped a diss track and then said he was sorry. He's like, I literally don't care. Kendrick, what you put out? Weak.
like it was butt. It was terrible. I just want to let I just think that's so good. You can tell Drake really took his time with this. He actually put a lot of thought into this, or at least I think so. He came out later and was like, yeah, it took me like an hour or two to write this. And people think that he's like lying about that. I think that people don't really think about just how long Drake has been rapping and writing raps. Like, if you're 20 years old, Drake was an extremely successful rapper when you were in like second or third grade. Like, people don't really think about how long he's been doing this and doing this at a very high level. Take Care won a Grammy. 13 years ago, Drake dropped a rap album that won a Grammy. Like, over a decade and a half, almost, of just consistent, like, top five popularity-wise rap success. And people are shocked that Drake is out here going hard in a rap beef like he doesn't know how to rap. I don't know. This is getting kind of long. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to highlight some of the best moments from the end of this song. So he says, begging Kai Cenat, boy, you not beating us. Basically, Kai Cenat is one of the biggest streamers in the world. He's saying that even if Kendrick Lamar were to get on his hands and knees and ask a streamer to react to his song, like it wouldn't matter. Drake does numbers that no other rapper is comparing to these days. He says that money-wise, I'm out of here. You not sneaking up. He says, cornball, your show money, merch money fee to us, which is basically saying what Kendrick Lamar makes when he does a entire show is what Drake makes just by selling merch at any given time, which is quite a flex. Towards the end of the song, Drake says that this isn't even really everything that I have. Like, I have more. And the next time I talk about this, I'm going to talk about how Drake drops yet another diss track before Kendrick even has time to respond to this one, which was kind of dedicated to like a lot of people, like over half a dozen people. The next one Drake drops is pretty much all about Kendrick Lamar. It's three whole verses. It's an entire other song. But yeah, I just wanted to let you guys know what was going on so far with the big three. Kendrick started it with the Like That verse. J. Cole tried to snap back, did apologize, unfortunately. Then Drake came back with the diss track that we just covered and with another one. So we'll get into that. Thank you all so much for tuning in. New episode tomorrow, or session rather. We'll see. Depends on how I'm feeling. I got to get this over to my editor so he can get this one out.
This episode is actually brought to you by New Canvassing Experience. If you live in a major city like Nashville, Austin, Texas, Dallas, Texas, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania.
That's one place.
Miami, Florida, San Diego, California, San Francisco, California. There is a job out there. If you are a nice, friendly, charismatic person who wants to be a professional face-to-face fundraiser, there is a job that's starting pay is $24 an hour. And in some of these offices, they are actually only working you 4 days a week and you get paid even more. There are also bonus opportunities for you to move up in the company. It's a job that I used to do, and now I am kind of on the media side of it. So give